Dear President, dear members, my name is Carl Günther Wilhelm Hopper. I am a naval architect. I studied at the Technische University Berlin, and now I am professor at the University of Stellenbosch. And I'm also running a company, Foil Assisted Ship Technologies, which is specialized in the development of hydrofoil supported catamarans and craft. The fundamental idea of the hydrofoil was developed over 100 years ago and can be understood when we look at figure 1, where the lift drag ratio of a foil and the hull is shown. Foil has a much better resistance behavior than the hull. So if we combine these two, we will also have an improved hull. That happened now. And over 100 years development, many hydrofoils were developed where hydrofoil is here understood as a hull craft, where we normally use a wing hydrofoil. And let's see what came out of all that. One of the later and very powerful hydrofoil, brass door, is here shown in the museum already. So why is it here? It's a big question. And to understand what happened is we have to look on this craft from a designer's point of view. And if they are getting extinct as talk goes around, there must be a strong reason for it. And here we see already some, because these foil structures are enormous. The ship weighs 240 tons and makes the ship very heavy, which again is a constraint because it needs more power and then it consumes more fuel. So hydrofoils need big power. And let's look on figure 3. Some other type of hydrofoils. The lower ones are surface piercing foils. They are stiff foils, they are not adjustable, and they get their stability due to the V-shaped foils with big parts sticking out of the water. So if it inclines somewhere, these come in and tighten the hydrofoil up again. They have some drawbacks also. They need very long propeller shaft, and the propeller must deeply be submerged, so it needs even stronger and longer struts. But they have been quite successful, especially Supramar type of hydrofoils, which go along the coast of Italy, and there are many others of this type as well. The top two, the Boeing type one, is a different way to organize the stability, because the foils are completely submerged all the time. They are regulated with a tack angle control. So when the ship runs in a wave, then the angle of the front foil is increased, so the ship can easily come over the foil. And this way, with computer programs, they can run very even and have practically no wave accelerations. If the sea gets very wild, they have to come down. And then they are a very bad monohull in rough water, which is very uncomfortable to the people. So all these are drawbacks. They can also not operate in shallow water. They need deep harbors and special piers and so on. So there are many drawbacks on hydrofoils, and that has resulted that normal pleasure boats and work boats are not hydrofoils, because they always go through shallow water, and some of them must land even on beaches. And therefore, only passenger and military hydrofoil exist. Figure 4 shows a hyzo kit. But it is actually also a hydrofoil, because it's a hydrofoil hybrid with a foil system, but the hull is a catamaran type boat. If you have a good look on the foil, you might have trouble to find it. The main foil is slightly fore of midships, and then there are two small rear foils near the transom, which are hardly visible. But they are there for trim stability. This ship was launched in 1982, and it was by the University Department developed to help police and Navy, who requested fast boats in areas with very strong waves, wind waves, very steep, very short wavelengths. And they had tried lots of imported boats, and they were not satisfying at all. So they requested something new. We started with a so-called T-boat, tunnel boat, which were used in offshore racing, and had taken very good positions up there. And the drawback was tunnel boats needed much more power than normal monohulls. And these tunnel boats are must be understood as split deep V hulls with a high dead rise angle of 24 degrees at least. They can pass the waves well and soft. So to reduce now the power requirement, I proposed a foil system, which I built a model for, in models in the dying tank and in a circulating tank, the small models of 50 centimeter and 1,2 meter. We tested them, and the theoretical thinking indicated the improvement of 20% must come out, but we were surprised. We got improvements of 40%. And that was actually so much that nobody would believe us, and that is also what happened. But the fact is, it is true, we proved that later by developing the theoretical background of these things. And these model tests gave already the right answer. The lower part of the picture shows the BMI model. BMI stands for Bureau for Mechanical Engineering, who had sponsored this project. At high speed, it comes well out of the water, it takes a good trim angle up, and very small hull parts remain in the water, but they are strong enough to supply all the stability requirements. And we tested that boat over a whole year around the coast in South Africa. It was tested by captains from the Navy and the private industry and so on, and everybody was amazed. In 1 year, 40 ships of this type were built and sold, and that was the start of the development of Hyzocraft. And now I show you the sketches, the principal sketches of it. On the top, you see the main foil in the middle somewhere, which creates a downwash due to the lift creation, which goes over the rear foil, which also creates a downlift. And we had to now develop a theory of that. It was very complicated, and because the angle of attack of the foil changes with the angle of the hull naturally and so on. The position in the boat itself, in the tunnel, is slightly forward of the center of gravity, and the rear foils are always very near to the transom. If the main foil is put too far forward, the ship will take too high trim angles without porpoising. If it's too small, the improvements are not so big. So there is a size which is optimum. And the theoretical development through our software development needed many years to get that all together and properly predictable. And one point I want to still make here, the foil in the Heisekett hull reacts very differently than a free foil shown at R, figure 6R, the submerged foil. That is about accelerated water induced downstream, which creates a lift. And when the foil near the surface at B comes near the surface, then it accelerates less water downstream, but it also has less resistance. But in the combination of these two, C, the foil in the Heisekett near surface, the foil and the hull create a much larger downstream. And the fact is that the larger the downstream is, the better the efficiency of the boat plus foil. Here we see a tarring tank test in which many, many Heisekraft projects were tested, often as student projects. And this boat in the picture analysis is a model of the Sir David Brown luxury yacht at the time. This boat was now presented and got a Shell Design Award because the people were so convinced of the functioning of it and tested it well. And this is the first one for the University of Stellenbosch that they ever got such an award, because that normally goes to industry. Okay. Figure 9 shows two types of hydrofoil supported craft, a Heisekett, which we just explained and showed an example of. But we also developed a foil system for semi-displacement type demi-hulls. That needs a completely different foil system because the mid-range of this ship has a potential flow field with low pressure, and that doesn't allow a good hydrofoil combination. So it's a front foil far forward of the center of gravity and the one near to the transom. We have built some of these. It's normally the larger ferry boats and so on, where this fit, and they also have given 30 to 40% improvement. And one of them is a Halter E-Cat, which was designed in the United States, Louisiana, as a demonstrator for a ferry of 45 meter and simulated 182 ton with a number of passengers on, and it normally reached 31 knots top speed with a water jet propulsion. The top you see the foil system with three struts in the middle and short struts under the keels, and in the back very low down, which nearly tips on a house here, is a stern foil, which is very deep because the deflected water due to the lift of the main foil drives the water down, so that it needs a different arrangement height-wise also. And the picture shows this foil system, which was taken when the ship was a bit lighter at 46 knots. You can see that the water going over the main foil gets white, and in certain instances completely white, so there is a different flow happening. The little bubbles in the water with the low pressure grow up, and then we have a mixed flow system air plus water. That has the advantage that it does not easily lead to cavitation damage on the foil. And the right picture shows how the foil ends sticking out of the ship, which the captain didn't like very much, and which needs more attention in the design, because it will be difficult to go on piers and along ships and so on when that foil sticks out there. One important thing is also the strut. It cannot be a vertical strut, because that would pull water, air into the water, which comes to the water jets, and then they don't function that well. And I think we go through a number of designs of hydrofoils now, just to give an impression what happened, because lots has happened. Lots of ships are built as hydrocats or hydrovax already, but many of them are out of our control and sometimes they don't function properly. So let's see what happened. Here we see the South African Navy by 20 meter patrol, and it also shows the main foil to give an impression how big the foils are in comparison to the previous hydrofoil. They are miniatures. We also use a strut often, because it can reduce the stress, especially in the attachment points where the foil is attached to the hulls. And the South African Navy had three built, and one extra one was sold to Namibia. They are for over 20 years in service. They run very softly, and now the crew likes these boats much more than the normal monohulls. This figure 12 shows a Thai Navy patrol boat with a Gatling gun. I mean, I mention that because it's the smallest craft which can carry a Gatling gun and shoot it still. The normal monohulls would capsize then. It was built by Technautic in Bangkok with support from the German company we had in the development, and it was supposed to reach 40 knots. It did not, because it became much heavier than planned, but it made 38 knots, and the Navy was happy about it. And the Gatling gun was tried one day. They shot some trees down, but this is a horrible machinery that you can be scared of. This one is figure 13, and that shows the Nordblitz, typical application of a passenger ferry. It has a servo gear propeller system shown on the right side, which is a very advantage for the craft, because that one also creates some uplift forces, and the pitch can always be adjusted for the maximum propeller efficiency. So the hump resistance is no problem, because the pitch goes down and there's the highest possible efficiency. This way it is better about 30% than normal fixed pitch propellers. The left side shows it's the tunnel doesn't touch the water, and has a middle strut on the foil, which we can see here. The foil system is a bit different than the above ones, and we call it the Kanadheiserkett foil system, and the ship was called Nordblitz. And this means the smaller foil is forward of the center of gravity, and the rear foil is between the center of gravity and the transom. This boat functions very well, and it is for 25 years or so in service in Egypt and surrounding countries for touristic transport. This one in figure 15 shows the 50 meter Stealth yacht. Call it 540. It was 22 to 25 tons, depending on load. It had 2 times 820 horsepower MAN diesels. It could reach 40 knots here with a Q-speed SP propeller system. Here again, the surface propellers give the big advantage, and some other surface propeller system were developed by Stealth and applied on some other of these yachts. There are about 8 built in the water now in the, around the world, and the one even registered a speed of 49 knots. This one is a U.S. Army Corps of Engineers survey boat, isocraft, built by Kuschak Marine in Seattle. The typical Hyzocat system was used with a full beam rear foil, which could be adjusted for trim corrections. And the Army Corps liked that very much because they did measurements in wavy weather and so on the sea. And these boats made a very nice script where other boats make a big vibration up and down with a script. So one had to find the middle value there, but here it was a plain result. And there were about 8 or 9 built of different sizes and hull variations afterwards. Here, figure 17 shows the Alpha J80. Which we developed with a styling design by Louis de Basto. He is also in the United States and in Italy with his offices. And it shows that yacht on a catamaran hull can also be made very nice, because the talk is going around that catamaran hulls as yachts are looking ugly. It's my dream that I get this ship still on the water, because the investor came in financial trouble and the whole project was iced up. And picture 18 shows the Alpha Yacht Performance Diagram with Camira water jets. It's a 440 R3. And for people who are more interested in it, it also shows a problem area around 10 to 20 knots, where the center of gravity is very important. And when the boat is in overload, it could create problems and cuts into these zones 1, 2, or 3, which indicates cavitation, where it can only be used short time. But at the higher speed, there is no problem with this. And the ship made 55 knots, and in lighter conditions even 60. Feature 19 shows a resistance displacement ratio of sea craft. When a new craft is developed, towing tests are conducted and the resistance is measured. Then the resistance is correlated. There's a whole design necessary to get the correlation right. But once the resistance is known, one develops the resistance weight ratio, like the drag weight ratio corresponding. And if one looks on different boat types, then one can see which speed range is favorable for that new design. And we don't use the speed in knots, but in a dimensionless form as a fruit displacement number, which is given here on the x-axis. So if you look on displacement craft, they are very good at very low speeds up to foot number 2. Then they rise very strong and steadily. It's normally the wave making resistance which does that. So they are very unfavorable up to foot numbers of 4, but they are normally never used at these high speeds. Then we see hard giant deep V-hulls. That is now also the hulls which is, are used in hydrofoils and so on. Flat bottoms make bad behavior, so they're getting deep V. That means 24 degree or 18 degrees at least dead rise angle. They are not as good as displacement hull in the lower speed range. And they are very heavily loaded. They have a very high hump resistance. But at the higher speeds, they are steadily rising. And the interesting story is that hard giant deep V craft are most of the boats around the whole world in these size ranges, so 10 to 30 meter. So these could be vastly improved by isocut systems, you know. There is also a range shown for hydrofoil craft, which is based on the the classical isocraft. And it is relatively better, but at a very high speed, this is also creating quite some resistance. Then we have put some isocats in. Isocat 5, for example, is 10 meter and 7.1 tons, and the resistance is shown there. And some other isocats, so they are considerably better than all these other type of hulls. So now we go over to figure 20, which shows the well-known transport efficiency, but in inverse form. We call it the EPS, which is giving the comparison of the boats incomplete. The above diagram was only the hull itself. But when we want to compare ships, we must compare the powers of that. And that leads to the propulsion efficiency is built in the factor here, epsilon over propulsive coefficient. And also we draw this diagram very similar to the top one. Over foot displacement number. Here we see again a round bilge displacement craft at low speeds, and round bilge hulls also very good at low speeds, but from foot number 2 on, other craft become better, and there is also a hydrofoil craft tendency curve from the old hydrofoils. And I also put in a hydrocraft supported craft line, the red one. And the very interesting thing here is we had very recently a project to design a foil system to world record breaking trimaran built in Ireland by Safehaven Marine. And here we calculated out before the run how it fits to other craft. And the top one, which are called 50, means at 50 it is cruising speed, because diesel engine cannot always run for full power, but 50R is full power diesel. The hull without foils is already much better than a normal deep V-planing craft. But after we fitted the foil system, we get the red points 49 and 49A. And that is now Sander Scheidt world record boat. So the foils improved from the Black 50 to the Red 90, which is about 40% or so, and that actually allowed a record to be broken. And that is not theory only, that is real bouts here, and we will have a good look at these bouts very soon. So for people who want to know how their bout fits in comparison to other bouts, they can build these parameters up, which we also have listed here in the next table, which we call hydrodynamic performance comparison of high-speed small craft. So we need from about the displacement in ton, the speed in knots, the power in kilowatt, and we can make the Froude number with it, and then we can build the EPS value up, and that one we can plot in the previous diagram. And we have seen how that looks like, but we also wanted to have a simplified rating number. We call that hydrodynamic power rating, which is the Froude number divided by the EPS. And you can see that's the right corner of that thing, what type of ships have what rating number. That rating number is one number, and it gives immediately indicates what kind of efficiency can expect from this type of bout. So we have deeply planning craft, we have hydrofoil craft, and we have recently built craft. So there are many points in. The HPR never reaches more than 30. But 30 is a very, very efficient craft, and some hovercraft and some SAS craft come near to that. And the hydrofoils come also well in, but not that high. But I also put the record running performance of the Zander Shy 2 in here under number 49, 48, and so on, and 50. And we see that the rating number is 26.176 at full speed, and at average speed 24.117. So it shows that the Heizer-Cat in this Thundershed was actually a trimaran, and the foils are converting it to a isocraft, you know, kind. So this is actually the proof that isocraft, isocat, and isovac are functioning well and practically unbeatable when one considers also the simplicity of the building of it, you know. Figure 21 shows the Zander Shy 2 at a good speed. Typical appearance of it, it is a catamaran type with a monohull port in the front. And the big plume behind comes from the surface propellers. Here we see the surface propellers. It looks a bit involved, but they are adjustable slightly, and they are built by Franz Elise, which are very experienced in surface propellers. The tunnel is there, visible, which must be free, and the propellers must not swing into the tunnel. And here, this is a hydrofoil system which we designed. So you see the main foil spanning the tunnel, and a middle strut going to the ceiling of the craft. The craft has also some steps inside and so on to the direct step water down. And in the back, you see the two twin foils, which trim correct the bout at speed. And here the Zander Shy is shown with the instrument insights about indicating 54,2 knots. And that is also the maximum speed it was running in the world record break. On table two, I must explain still, before they made the record break, we calculated the hydrodynamics of it. And the ship was a bit lighter than originally designed for the Atlantic crossing. And the LCG could be corrected by a tank in the front of the boat. And this table gives all the hydrodynamic data, like the speed, the resistance, the trim angle at speed, the effective power, and the real power of the engines, the fuel consumption, and what range it can reach, and also consumption data and the EPS data, the FND data. And if you divide now the fruit number at 50 knots and divide it by 0,194, you get that rating number, which I showed you in the previous diagrams. For people who are more interested, they can go to our PDF file, which runs parallel to this talk. Also, the figures numbers are a bit changed, but then one could rework anything from that diagram. And then the record was broken on the 9th of August 2020. And the run was over the course at Cork, Fastnet, Rock, and back to Cork. And we will show you a video how the ship is running in waves at high speed. So if there are interested parties for more information, they can please visit our website at www.hydrocraft.com. And in conclusion now, I want to say that hydrofoils will not die out, but their appearance might change. Our three proposals, which we developed through over many years and which have proved very well functioning, mean that the background is proper. We have developed the software that everybody could actually design optimized hydrocraft when they would have the software. And we are offering that to companies to use us in collaboration for it, you know. But the hydrofoil will become the classical hydrofoils will become museum objects, or they get in the mothball, like in the United States, where they keep them intact in case they find a need for them in future years. So I want to thank you for your patience to listen to this long talk now. Thanks to the Hydrofoil Society, and they actually should exist well on into the future, because it is absolutely necessary to make such developments public, that everybody can understand the way development in future will go. Thank you very much.